Hello guys, welcome to this new channel, Literature and Language. This channel has been created for uploading videos regarding literature and other literary stuffs. I am a student currently pursuing my master's in English literature. So without further ado, let's get into this video. This video deals with Beowulf, which is an Anglo-Saxon epic. Now before going to discuss it thoroughly, we need to understand its background, history and the composition. This has been very important for the student of English literature to discuss and study the background of anything they are going to study, because without it one cannot acquire the full knowledge of any concerned topic. You can get the details of Anglo-Saxon poetry and of the period. If you want, I can make a video on this separately, but in today's video I will briefly discuss about Beowulf. This has been quite distinct that poetry made its appearance before prose, but lots of manuscripts of Anglo-Saxon period were discovered many years later, and they were pagan in outlook and were edited by the hands of the Christian writers after England got converted into Christianity in 597 AD. There are lots of confusions and contradictions regarding the composition of the poem, but let me say this is a poem of 3183 lines, and this poem deals with the Scandinavian theme. There is hardly any word mentioned about England. It was first published at Copenhagen in 1815. The theme, character and setting of the poem are all Scandinavian. Now we will discuss the thematic analysis of this poem. One of Halfdan's son was Hrothgar, and with him the story of Beowulf, the hero of the poem, begins. In his old age, Hrothgar builds a splendid hall called Hjorot, where the king and his thanes gathered nightly to feast and to listen to the songs of his gleemen. His happiness is however destroyed by the monster Grendel, who breaks into the hall every night and devours as many as 30 warriors at a time. No weapon can harm the monster, with the result that Hjorot is left deserted and silent. The nightly raids of Grendel goes on for 12 years, and the rumors of Grendel's raid at last reaches the land of Geats, where a young man of superhuman strength and vigor lives under the roof. His name is Beowulf. When Beowulf hears of this cruel raid, he determines to go to the assistance of Hrothgar. With 14 companions, Beowulf crosses the sea and reaches the Danish coast. Now he was welcomed warmly and joyously by Hrothgar at Hjorot. When silence prevails, Grendel enters ferociously into the hall and devours one of companions after tearing him entirely. Then the monster lays his hand on Beowulf and knows that at last he had made his match, but Beowulf with his vigor and strength seizes one of his arm and after a desperate fight wrenches it off the shoulder. Then Grendel escapes in severe pain, and streaming forth blood plunges into the sea to pay the debt of nature. Hrothgar praises Beowulf for his victory and rewards him with rich gifts. A feast follows in honor of Beowulf, and the queen also congratulates him and presents him with a valuable necklace. But this is not the end. Here comes Grendel's mother at midnight for the revenge of her son. Beowulf was summoned by her, and he, with his companions, sets out for the dwelling place of Grendel's mother. A desperate fight follows, and ultimately Beowulf succeeds in killing her with a magic sword he finds in the cave. He finds the dead body of Grendel in the cave and cuts off its head. Taking the head, he swims back to the shore where his faithful companions are waiting for him. The Danes have already left the shore thinking that Beowulf will never return, but his companions ultimately felt really glad to see their hero, and again the king congratulates him on his unbelievable feat of bravery. And the following day Beowulf takes leave of Hrothgar and sails back with his faithful companions to his homeland. Many years have elapsed. Beowulf has become the king of the Geats and has reigned over them gloriously for 50 years. When he was standing on the western sky of his life, his kingdom comes to be ravaged by a ferocious dragon who gets furious because some jewels are stolen from an ancient treasure which he has guarded for 300 years. Beowulf, greatly angered, resolves to attack the dragon. With some companions, he sets out for the dragon's lair. The dragon rushes in upon him, and Beowulf strikes him on the head by the sword. But the sword breaks, and the dragon seizes him by the neck. There is a mortal combat, but ultimately, with the heroic grandeur, Beowulf was successful in executing the pernicious dragon. But he himself is mortally wounded during the encounter with the dragon, and he dies, consoled by the thought that by his death he has not only snatched away his people from the jaws of death, but also gained for them a hoard of treasures. His body is burnt on the great pyre, and a huge barrow is constructed over the remains of the pyre. Now, I have completed discussing the brief thematic analysis of this epic, and now comes the most interesting part of this video. I have given few topics to be considered because these topics are very important at university exams. Now you can study the topics, and I can assure you, you will not be disillusioned. The topics are Beowulf as an epic, as a picture of ancient Teutonic life, Christian elements in Beowulf. If you need any kind of help regarding these three topics, you can let me know in the comment box by commenting your needs. I will be really grateful to help you. So all this was for the video. If you like this video, and if you want more help on this topic, or even if you want to study further on this concerned topic, you can comment in the comment box. And please subscribe the channel, share this video if you like it. Thank you.